Hello students, happy to be able to reach to you all. The first thing which I want to say is, let us all together fight against Corona. So in an effort to fight against Corona, this is my next video lecture for you people. Now in this video lecture, I'm going to describe conservation law and Burger's equation. The first thing that I'm going to describe is conservation law. And when we derive a mathematical equation for the conservation law, then we will eventually describe an equation called Burger's equation. But firstly, let me start with conservation law. A few words about conservation laws or laws of conservation. The first thing is, what are conservation laws or what are laws of conservation? Now, conservation laws or laws of conservation are fundamental laws of nature. Fundamental in the sense that they describe which processes can occur in nature and which processes cannot occur in nature. Now, if you state a conservation law of any property, then a simple statement of conservation law of any property, whether it is conservation law of mass or it is conservation law of energy or it is conservation law of momentum, then the conservation law of any property would be that the total quantity of that property, whatever property it is, whatever property we are talking of, whether it is mass or energy or linear momentum or angular momentum, then the total quantity of that property remains unchanged during physical processes. The total quantity of that property does not change during physical processes. Now, in this particular article, we are going to describe that article which I'm going to describe in this lecture. In this particular article, I'm going to describe a local conservation law. Although there are global conservation laws also, but we are going to concentrate on local conservation law. And what is a local conservation law? A local conservation law is a law which states that for conserved quantity of any material, whatever material you are considering, whatever material is you are taking at that point, whether it is a liquid or a gas, so for the conserved quantity of a material to change, there must be a flow or flux of that material. So if you are taking any particular material and if you are taking any conserved quantity of that material, and the conserved quantity of that material would change only if there is a flow of that material or there is a flux of that material. So that is the local conservation law. Now, a local conservation law can be expressed mathematically by a partial differential equation, and that partial differential equation is called a continuity equation. So in this particular article which I am now going to describe, we are going to discuss a conservation law, and in that conservation law, in the end, we will get a partial differential equation which will be called a continuity equation. So let me start with the conservation law. So what we do is we consider a volume V of the material, whatever material we are taking, whether it is a liquid or a gas, and we take a fixed volume of that material, and suppose V is surrounded by the surface area S, and we are working in the XYZ space. You can see the three coordinates, XYZ space. So we take a volume V, and this is bounded by a surface area. The volume capital V is bounded by the surface area capital S. Now in that volume V, which is bounded by the surface area S, we take a infinitesimal or a small volume dV, and suppose dS is the corresponding surface area. Here n, the vector n which you can see in the figure, this is the outward drawn unit normal on the surface area S, and the vector q which you can see in the figure, this is nothing but the flux vector, where flux is nothing but it is the amount of, or it is the volume of fluid, volume of the material flowing through the surface area S per unit time. So this represents the this is a flux vector, where flux is the volume of the fluid, which volume of the material, whatever material you are taking, which flows through the surface area per unit time. Now coming to the statement of the local conservation law which we are considering, it states that the rate of change of total amount of material in volume V is equal to the flux of that material. You can see is equal to the flux of that material across the surface S. So the rate at which the total volume, the rate at which the total amount of the material contained in volume V changes, the rate at which the volume V changes, this is equal to the flux or the flow of that material across the surface S. So this is the statement of the conservation law which we are considering. And mathematically, if you describe this conservation law, then the left hand side, this left hand side describes the rate at which the total amount of material changes in the volume V. So because it is rate, so we are taking derivative with respect to time, d by dt integral rho dv over the volume V. Rho represents the density of the material. This is equal to the right hand side represents the flux of that material, the flux or the flow of that material across the surface S. So this is minus integral S dot product of Q and N ds. So this is the integral over S, and minus sign is taken because this whole thing represents the outward flux, because the material is moving outside. So the negative sign comes because this is the outward flux. So this is the mathematical expression for conservation law. And as usual, as I said here, N, which is the it is the outward drawn unit normal to the surface area S. Now this mathematical form of the conservation law, which I have marked as 1, we are going to represent this mathematical form in a form which is called the differential form. So now I am going to derive what is called a differential form of the conservation law, and for this purpose we use Gauss divergence theorem. And we know that Gauss divergence theorem is a theorem which relates the volume integral with the surface integral. It relates the triple integral with the double integral. So according to the Gauss divergence theorem, integral divergence of vector Q over the volume V dV, this is equal to integral dot product of Q dot N over S dS. So this statement of Gauss divergence theorem I am marking as 2, where divergence of Q, Q is the flux vector, divergence of Q is equal to del dot Q by definition of the divergence of a vector, and the value of the operator del, this is the del operator or the Nabla operator, the value of the operator del is this, which is del by del x I plus del by del y j plus del by del z k dot q. And now if you put the value of q, q was the flux vector, and if q denotes the value, the component of the flux vector in x direction, r denotes the component of the flux vector in y direction, and s denotes the component of the flux vector in the z direction, then this is the expression that we have. And now when you take the dot product of these two vectors, by definition of the dot product in vector calculus, there are three terms that you get. The first term is del q by del x plus del, second term is del r plus del r by del y plus del s by del z. So this is the value of divergence of q. And now using this value of divergence of q, here this is the value of divergence of q, and now just using the value of this surface integral, which is expressed in terms of the volume integral, this I use this value in expression 1. So I substitute the value of the surface integral over here, and now this is what you finally get. So using the value of the surface integral, this as this, this is v. So this is the conservation law in mathematical form. This was the conservation law, that the this was represented the rate of change of material, and this represented the outward flux. So just putting the value of the outward flux as this, just using the value as this, this expression is the Gauss divergence theorem. So this is what we get finally. We don't need this term in the middle, so we just exclude it. Finally you have d by dt integral v rho dv plus this term I bring on the left hand side, and plus integral v divergence q dv is equal to 0. And now assuming that the differentiation and integral, they can be interchanged, they are interchangeable, so this derivative sign I take inside, and here this is the expression that you have after taking the derivative sign inside. And finally taking the two terms together and integral sign outside, this is the integrand that you have. Integral of del rho by del t plus divergence q integral over v, this is equal to 0. And this expression I have marked as 3. Now 3 is true for any arbitrary volume V, whatever volume V we take. Now if the integrand, this particular integrand, if it is continuous and if it is non-negative, then this particular integrand will be 0 everywhere. So assuming that the condition of continuity and non-negativity is true, by the result of real analysis, we have that the integrand will come out to be 0. So the integrand comes out to be 0. So therefore, we have del rho by del t plus divergence q is equal to 0. And del rho by del t, this is equal to, this can be represented as rho t. So in short, I am representing it as rho t over here. you can see, plus divergence Q is equal to 0. Here rho is the density of the material, and rho here is assumed to be a function of the space variables x, y, z. We are working in the x, y, z space and the time t, and the flux vector, as far as the flux vector is concerned, that is also assumed to be a function of the space variables and time t. So this equation, which we have marked as 4, this is the differential form of conservation law. So this equation, which is the continuity equation, is the differential form of the conservation law. And as an example, if we derive the law of conservation of mass for a compressible fluid, then those who are familiar again with the physics in details, then they might be knowing that if you derive the law of conservation of mass for a compressible fluid, a compressible fluid is a fluid whose density changes as the fluid flows, and liquids are compressible fluids, gases are compressible fluids. So if you derive the law of conservation of mass for a compressible fluid, then the form of the law of conservation of mass of compressible fluid comes out to be an expression which is similar to 4. So that completes the article for differential form of conservation law. Now, we have already derived the conservation law in mathematical form, which is the differential form we have derived already. And the differential form of the conservation law is rho t plus divergence q is equal to 0. This equation I had marked as 4. So, this we have already derived. Now, we can write this equation 4 in a different form, writing it as rho t is as it is plus del dot q is equal to 0. Divergence q, I'm writing it as del dot q. And divergence q, we had seen del dot q had 3 terms. There were 3 terms that we had written in the previous slide. Del q by del x plus del r by del y plus del s by del z, q r s. So if you take the one dimensional version of the conservation law, the one dimensional version of the conservation law, which means that I am just considering the x, only the x direction, I am not working in the x, y, z space, then this is the one dimensional version of the conservation law. Del rho by del t plus del q by del x is equal to 0. This I have marked as 5. So this is the one dimensional version of the conservation law. We are actually discussing a few notes regarding the conservation law which we have just derived. So this is the first note that I have discussed. Now coming to the second note. Now in many physical problems, there are many physical problems in which Q is assumed. Q is the component of the flux vector. This was the flux vector, and the component of the flux vector in the x direction is Q. So Q is assumed to be a function of the density gradient. This is the density gradient, rho x. And density gradient is the spatial variation in the density, and this is the density. So Q is assumed to be a function of two variables, the density gradient and the density, in many physical problems. So a simple model we are discussing, in a simple model we take Q to be something like this, that is Q is equal to P rho, capital P, which is a function of rho, minus A. A is a positive constant, rho x. So this expression I have marked as 6. So sometimes if you take, sometimes Q can be assumed to be this for constructing a simple model. So if you take your Q to be this, then putting the value of Q, this expression we have marked as 6, and putting the value of Q from 6 in 5. So here I put the value of Q. Putting the value of Q from 6 and 5, del rho by del t is as it is, plus del by del x, this is the value of Q, p rho minus a, rho x is equal to 0. And now rho t, I write del rho by del t as rho t in short. And now you take the derivative of p rho, p is a function of, capital P is a function of rho. So chain rule I apply. So derivative of p with respect to rho, this is the derivative of p with respect to rho, and derivative of p, derivative of rho with respect to x. So if you take the derivative of this expression, del by del x, if you take of the function capital P, then it will be derivative of p with respect to rho and rho with respect to x. So these are the two terms which you have, and minus a del by del x of rho x. Now, or this particular expression, the next expression that we get is rho t plus p dash rho this I'm marking as, this I'm writing as 0. This will be, this you can, in short, I'm writing it as 0. This is going to be some function of rho. I'm calling it as 0. And del rho by del x, I'm writing it as rho x minus a. This will be rho xx, the second order partial derivative of rho. And 0, as I just said, this is nothing but p dash. And the value of 0 is p dash rho. In short, I just told you that 0 has been written, p dash rho in short has been written as 0. And p dash rho is d rho by dp by d rho, because p is a function of rho. So this is dp by d rho. So this equation, this particular equation can be written as rho t plus c rho rho x. And this expression we take on the right hand side. So rho t plus c rho rho x is equal to a rho xx. This expression I am marking as 7. And this is a diffusion equation. This is called a diffusion equation, and it is a nonlinear equation. This is the expression, this is the term which is making it this equation nonlinear, because an expression of containing rho is multiplied with the derivative of rho. So this is the expression which makes it nonlinear. So this equation 7 is a diffusion equation. Now writing equation 7 in a different form, assuming that c rho was equal to p dash rho, assuming that c rho, this particular function is differentiable, that is c dash rho exists. I assume that c dash rho exists. I multiply equation 7 with c dash rho on both the sides. So the first term that we have is c dash rho rho t plus c rho. C rho is, I have taken outside, and c dash rho I have combined with, I have taken it with rho x, is equal to a c dash rho rho xx. And again, c dash rho can be written as c by d rho, because c is a function of rho. So c dash rho is dc by d rho. And rho t can be explicitly written as del rho by del t plus c rho. And again, c dash rho is dc by d rho, and rho x is del rho by del x. And this is equal to c dash rho rho xx. So this is the expression that we have. Now, this whole expression is ct, which is the derivative of c with respect to t, because we are differentiating c with respect to rho and rho with respect to t. So chain rule we are applying. So this is the derivative of c with respect to t, just using chain rule. And plus c rho, this is as it is. And again, here we apply chain rule, derivative of c with respect to rho and rho with respect to x. So I write this as cx is equal to a c dash rho rho xx. This particular term I add and subtract. This is a small manipulation that I do. I add and subtract c double dash rho rho square x, and I subtract c double dash rho rho square x, assuming that the function c rho, this is not only differentiable once, but it is differentiable twice with respect to rho. So c double dash rho exists. So adding and subtracting this, and now ct plus c rho, this particular expression in the left remains the same. And here this is equal to a c x x. This I'll just tell you about this expression. But these two terms, this term and this term, they are taken together. These two terms are taken together. And when you take them together, then these two terms are equal to c x x. The reason I will just tell you. And minus c double dash rho rho square x, this particular expression is as it is. And as far as c x x is concerned, c x x means the double derivative of c with respect to x, which is nothing but c rho, the derivative, partial derivative of c rho with respect to x, and the derivative of c rho with respect to x, and c rho with respect to x again two times. And c rho, when you differentiate with respect to x, this is the, this derivative is going to be dc. Here it is going to be dc by d rho, because c is a function of rho. So this is dc with respect to rho and rho with respect to x. So this is the value of this expression, which I have written over here. And again, the partial derivative with respect to x remains outside. And dc by d rho can be written as c dash rho. So I have written this. And del rho by del x can be written as rho x. So again, now solving, now finding out the value of this derivative. So again, here when you differentiate this expression with respect to x, this is going to be derivative of c with respect to rho and rho with respect to x. This is the derivative of c dash rho with respect to x, derivative of c dash rho with respect to rho and rho with respect to x, and rho x is as it is, plus product rule I'm using, product rule of differentiation, plus c dash rho is as it is, and derivative of rho x with respect to x is rho xx. So I have used product rule of differentiation over here. And then c double dash rho, rho square x, this is the expression which you have from here, plus c dash rho, rho xx. So this is the value of cxx, and this value of cxx, this value has been replaced by cxx over here. So this whole expression is actually cxx. And the reason I have just given you that if you find out the value of cxx, this is what you have. So cxx, I have just replaced this expression by cxx. So left hand side as it is remains the same. Ct plus c rho cx, this is the left hand side. That left hand side has not changed. It just remains the same. And in the right hand side, you have a cxx is inside minus c double dash rho, rho square x. So this is the final equation that you have, which I have marked as equation 8. Here c rho, the value c rho was a function which was used to represent p dash rho. P was, capital P was a function of rho, and q, which is the component of the flux vector in the x direction, this was taken to be of the form p rho minus a rho x, where a was a positive constant and rho x was the density gradient, the spatial variation in the density, and rho was the density. So this is another form of the nonlinear diffusion equation, where we have assumed that c rho, this is differentiable once as well as twice. Okay, so now we are going to derive Berger's equation. So a few notes in this regard. Now we have already derived a form of the nonlinear diffusion equation, which is equation 8, which is this. So this was derived in the last slide, where p dash rho, which is the derivative of p rho, p is, capital P is a function of rho, so p dash rho has been represented in short by c rho. So this particular equation, which is equation 8, which this we have derived in the last slide. And this is a form of a nonlinear diffusion equation, where we are assuming that c rho is differentiable not only once but also twice. So c dash rho and c double dash rho both exist. Now p rho, which is a function of rho, if this is assumed to be a quadratic function in rho, if it is a quadratic function in rho, means that it is of degree 2 in rho, then if you take p dash rho, which means that if I take the derivative of p with respect to rho, then that will be, that will have degree 1 less than p rho, which means that p dash rho will be a linear function. But p dash rho is c rho, so c rho will be a linear function, or it will be a function of degree 1. Then if you calculate p double dash rho, which means that I am differentiating capital P twice with respect to rho, then it will be of degree 0 in rho, which means that p, but p double dash rho is c dash rho, so c dash rho will be of degree 0 in rho, and degree 0 means that c dash rho will be a constant. And now if you differentiate c dash rho again with respect to rho, which means that if I calculate c double dash rho, then c double dash rho will come out to be 0, just because the derivative of a constant is 0. So this fact I am marking as 9, that c double dash rho is equal to 0. And using this fact that c double dash rho is 0, in equation 8 at this point, when you use c double dash rho as 0, then this particular term vanishes, rest all terms remain same, and instead of writing c as c rho as c rho all the time, you can just simply write it as c. So the left hand side remains intact, and the in the right hand side this particular term vanishes. And finally, this is the form of equation that you get when p rho is a when c double dash rho comes out to be 0, and when we are assuming that p rho, that this particular function p is a quadratic function in rho. So the form of the equation comes out to be this. This is ct plus ccx is equal to a cxx. This form we are marking as equation 10, where of course I just said that c rho, instead of writing it as c rho, I am just writing it as c, and c rho is another way of representing p dash rho, because p dash rho is a function of rho. So in short, I am writing it as c rho, and p rho in this particular case we are assuming to be quadratic in rho. So now this form of equation, this form which is the equation 10, will be used to describe Berger's equation in a simple model of turbulence. This c, Now, in a simple model of turbulence, which we are now going to discuss, this C, which occurs in equation 10, which we have just derived, the C is replaced by the fluid velocity field uxt. Now, fluid velocity field is a vector field used to represent the motion of a fluid, where u is the velocity and it is a function of the position x and time t. So this is a vector field which is used to represent motion. So C which is occurring in equation 10, here in equation 10, this C is replaced by the fluid velocity u. So when you make this replacement, this is the equation 11 that you obtain after making the replacement of C with the u. So the equation is ut plus uux is equal to no uxx, where the constant A, the positive constant A, has been written instead of positive constant A, we have written no, but no is playing the same role as positive constant A. Now, nu represents in this case kinematic viscosity, where informally viscosity would mean the thickness of a fluid. More is the viscosity, thicker is the fluid. Just as an example, honey has more viscosity than water because honey is thicker than water. So nu stands for the kinematic viscosity. Now this equation 11 that we have obtained is Berger's equation, which we were looking for. So this is the discussion, this is the derivation for Berger's equation, where a few points about Berger's equation. Berger's equation is the simplest non-linear model equation for diffusive waves in fluid dynamics. This is a non-linear equation because you can see this particular term in Berger's equation, u ux. This is a non-linear term because u is multiplied with the derivative of u with respect to x. So this is a non-linear term. And this equation, which is the Berger's equation, was developed by a Dutch physicist, J. Berger's, for studying turbulence. So it was first developed by J. Berger's. And this Berger's equation occurs in many physical problems, like for example the problem of one-dimensional turbulence and the sound waves in viscous medium and waves in fluid-filled viscous elastic tube. So these are some of the physical problems where the Berger's equation occurs. Now this completes the discussion for Berger's equation.